I don't know. It's, it's interesting.
I haven't heard much about New York's transportation. I've heard more about how it's kind of considered somewhat of a walkable city, at least compared to world cities like Miami.
It is definitely more walkable, from my personal anecdotal experience. Manhattan, at the very least, is as walkable of a city could possibly be. It's like the size doesn't even... It's not about the size of the city. It doesn't affect the walkability. It's, did you plan for this to be walkable? And every street there... I mean, I was able to walk happily from all the way from the Empire State Building toward, you know, through, what do you call it, beautiful lighted lit district.
Times Square?
Times Square, all the way to Central Park if I wanted to.
That's nice.
No issue. I have some good news, though.
What?
We have some pizza that's just as good as most of their pizza. Sorry to tell you, okay? We got some good pizzas here. You got to find the right place. We don't have as
you
many.
You think Casolas is good?
Which one?
Casolas?
Casolas. I haven't had Casolas in such a long time. I probably had that as a kid, so I can, I can't really.
I like
But, you know, God, Sir Pizza's delicious. The one that's in Key
West. Thank you. Now you made me crave it.
The, too bad, man. You're going to eat. You got to eat, man. You got to eat the pizza.
Thank you very much.
Miami's Best Pizza's got some good stuff.
Miami's Best Pizza.
Ironically.
I've heard a lot of things about Big Cheese New York really deep dish stuff. Pizza. You know, I always hear that expression. Like, that, like, you might as well call it the Big Pizza instead of the Big Apple at this point.
Huh? Right? The Big Cheese.
The Big... Oh, yeah, good one.
But,
We in no way are sponsoring or advertising for any companies.
No, of course. Well, obviously. That'd be nice. That'd be great. If you'd like to pay us, please let us know. That'd be awesome. We'll say things like Pizza Hut or...
By the way, if you want to contribute to this pizza discussion, please do so at 786-309-8861. Once again, that's 786-309-8861.
Yeah, if you know a pizza place that I definitely what I'm talking about. Like, there's some really good places. I don't even know the names of most of them. Like, I just find them randomly sometimes when I'm like, okay, never been here, let me try it. They look like a nice place, and then it's just a delicious pizza.
Right. But,
so, enjoy that.
I definitely do feel a lot when you mention transportation, because for me, it's always been one of the bigger issues here in Miami as a commuter, because, you know, they haven't updated the train since the 80s, and now it looks like they're actually taking the first step in doing so, which is wonderful, because, my God, finally we have air conditioning, which is...
I can't believe this. Well, you know, that I can believe that, because I've been in a couple different trains in different cities, and, like, they don't have air conditioning most of the time. It's just like, okay, here's your little...
Right, of course, and when a lot of people congregate in the trains with no air conditioning, it gets very uncomfortable very quickly.
I can imagine.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, if you can't tell, I don't take public transportation very often. Right. I have a car.
But even then, you being a driver, I imagine there's still issues with the roads and
exactly.
Traffic.
Oh, no. It doesn't... you're right.
Like, there's a payoff for each method.
You see driving a car around Miami exactly what we're talking about here. It's not made for anybody to get anywhere coherently. Mm. There's no... You know...
There's no cohesiveness in the actual road system, because a lot of them are very detached from each other, and just
you can be like 5 miles,
practically
5 miles of road away from somewhere, and that 5 miles can cost you anywhere between, let's say, 15 minutes to something like an hour sometime.
Right.
Really, and you have no, you know, you have kind of a clue, you know, around 6 o'clock. Okay, well, it's when it's going to happen during the weekdays, and but sometimes you know. Otherwise, you really have no clue, and you can wind up so stranded. You know, I just feel like somebody would want to have fixed that. Somebody could fix that. I don't know who.
Right.
I don't know how you go about fixing it.
Maybe like, that would involve a major effort. Like, you need a task force and that and everything. Like, you need, like, just really active support, and you don't really...
I don't see how they could fix the road issues. I mean, a lot of the issues is road placement, and the fact that we've just decided to populate certain areas over others,
right?
And the population of areas does not coincide with the logical lay of the land.
It could just be they don't have enough subsidies to really fund any infrastructure plan that they could come up with. I can't really confirm any of that, but, you know, that could be a factor.
Yeah. So, let's break out with a song, huh?
Yeah, sure.
Sound good?
Got another song for you all, and please stay tuned. We will be right back.
Uh-huh.
The University of Miami has turned us on. Now it's our turn to turn you on. So keep your FM dial tuned to the 90.5 spot. WVUM, the voice of the Hurricanes.
Monkey House, everyone. That was Snowy from Undertale, and that was also Icicle Mountain from Super Smash Bros. Melee, both of which are games that I really very much enjoy, and you've played one of them.
Oh, yes.
We play Melee every week. It's kind of a radio tradition of ours now.
Yeah, that's how we kind of wrap up the day.
Right. I main Ness, by the way. That is who I use all the time. You don't have a main, though, do you?
I really don't, you know.
I use Donkey Kong.
Donkey Kong just it feels right, you know. And
it just fits in with the theme of the general show.
Yeah. I mean, I used to use Marth a lot, but I don't pick one.
Right. Well, Marth is actually fine. I prefer Ike, but he doesn't come until Melee, I think. Brawl.
Mm.
Right.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We were just talking about Miami in general. Anything else you want to say on that? Or?
Well, not really. I don't need to.
Right. In general, we just need more attention to these areas, you know, transportation, infrastructure, road systems. And we really hope that this new mayoral administration, Francis Juarez, is that Juarez? One of those things. actually tackles those issues, because we very desperately need a pioneer for this sort of thing.
Yeah, if there's anything to really work on with the city, if we're going to be a bigger city,
right? Sure, yeah.
Work better, it's transportation. But
man. Yeah, increase like the level of skilled workers in this city, you know, in the technological industry, which we've already been kind of making some improvements on those, but we really need that to just take off.
You know what? That's you just reminded me. That's probably part of the issue. I've noticed that most of the tech jobs aren't here. Like, if you want a really good tech job, let's say you do physics or any kind of the sciences, right?
Sure.
You know, maybe there's like one or two tech jobs here in Miami or anywhere near Miami.
Sure.
All the rest of them are everywhere else. You know, whatever. Pick one. San Francisco, New York, or Utah, or whatever. Seattle, everywhere else. You know, we don't have those. And our skillful talent, our talented individuals and those, you know, whether it's programming or intense scientific applications, they leave.
Right.
So maybe it is very difficult to get together groups of individuals that could solve.
I'm sure that Miami's the state's issues. Official position on climate change is a factor, because you know if there's no one in the government encouraging, okay, we have to tackle this because we're like ground zero in the United States for climate change or whatnot, you know, then who wants to come? It's like what we're seeing in the EPA. If no one wants to tackle these issues, why should these scientists bother working? You know,
yeah,
it delegitimizes the agency, the industry, everything.
Yeah, but most of the time when you're studying science and you get into a position where you are researching, you're actively applying your knowledge, you know, you work in one how do you even say it, you pick a particular direction and you research that to the ends.
Right. Sure.
And so then all of a sudden all the scientists that have been working in the EPA, they've been focusing on their aspects of, it's you know, climate change isn't a subject. That's not how that works.
Right.
You know, you've got people that understand how to measure the levels of certain gases in the atmosphere. You've got people that know how to measure the impact of certain.
Right. It's more of a catch-all term for these sort of changes that we see in our world.
Yeah, and the problem with this catch-all term is that when you say, oh, I don't believe in a catch-all term, all of a sudden, all the people who had jobs related to this ridiculous term have no position to work on anymore, because God forbid, you know,
right,
your job of analyzing levels of CO2 today as opposed to what it is like or what it was like, let's say 60 years ago, based off of tanks of air that we have stored from that time. All of a sudden, you can't do that, because that has to do with this climate change thing that apparently some people, you know, think.
I didn't know we had tanks of air. That's pretty interesting.
Yeah, that's one of the ways that we detect those you know, those famous levels of CO2.
So we have like someone's breath from the 40s.
not quite. more like scuba tanks, right? From the 40s. They're not even scuba. It's just air. We've known for over 100 years now that the climate is something to take into account.
Mm.
Literally counting things.
Sure. Yeah.
And one way to do that is to have stored, as they did during the Industrial Revolution, tanks, just a bunch of tanks full of air.
Mm.
And then we measure a little, we get a little bit out of that.
Like compare it to today's atmosphere.
Yeah.
They're used as like controls, things like that.
Yeah, they do all that science stuff. That's what we do, you know. And it's all of a sudden, you know, people doing that, which is a very legitimate kind of data.
Just
not that specific
bus,
one, yeah. Yeah, but thrown under the bus. That's the point. That specific one, they don't actually have to do anymore, because we've gotten so much data since that time of that particular thing that we were talking about.
Right.
They've done that air comparison from the tank so much that it's irrefutable that the CO2 levels and all this are
recovering. Like, this really is just such a disappointing year for science and the federal government.
God, yes. Yeah. Well, there's a lot of glimmering hope, right? Ivanka Trump, she went out and and got a programming funding happening. And I mean, you're talking billions of dollars that were funneled into getting programming classes into our educational system. She spearheaded that. That was a nice thing. And also NASA was funded again. Like they had a discussion, and Trump said, "Oh no, of course we need NASA. Are you kidding me?" And did a thing.
Right. Although he's still been neglecting the EPA.
No, it's totally. There's a lot of terrible things for science. I'm just trying to.
Did you hear like the guy, or was it the guy who leads the what's it called, the health agency, or the guy who used to didn't believe in, or actually no, was it the EPA? I think it was the EPA who didn't believe in climate change or anything like that. Yeah, which doesn't really surprise me.
I don't know about that.
Wasn't his name?
So I haven't kept up with that, dude. Yeah, I think. If we were all to keep up with everything that's been happening with politics, we'd have an aneurysm. All right, in 2 years.
It's complicated. Yeah,
you know,
we only know like the big stories, but yeah, like this is stuff that like stories about the EPA is EPA is kind of stuff that I had to really dig into to really find out. It's and the reality is very tragic. You know, to see the scientists who have been working, you know, for quite a while. You know, especially during the Obama administration when the government actually recognized that climate change was a
Well, even before, yeah, like right. This isn't even an Obama thing. It's just science has never, sure. There's never been an attack on science, not in the last
like. No, but like that was when century. It really picked up, like during that administration, is what I'm trying to say. They even put it on their national security strategy, which did they put on it? Climate change, you know, like that. Oh, that's yeah, a focal
that
point.
Climate change, is a focal
and
point.
That's something that was actually removed from the strategy that was released, I think, earlier this week or last week in return of. In favor of one more focus on immigration,
because
it's
an easy card. It's right. Like the easiest card you can pull out of your deck and give to your fan base if you are the Trump administration. Because there are a lot of people who won't do the research to understand what climate change could be.
I feel like that's only totally like his fringe base, though. Real. Do you think like the more moderate conservatives of like don't believe in climate change, or
I've just met a lot of here's what it is: there are people who don't know about it, which is fine. The uninformed.
Sure.
Then there are people who know about it, and the people who have researched it unanimously agree that climate change isn't just like, oh, climate is always changing, but we are headed in a direction that requires remedy and observation.
That's the
whatever.
Monkey house for you.
Yep, yeah.
That's the monkey wrench.
And then there's another group. There's a group that is uninformed, but will have an opinion anyways.
Sure.
And that's the danger that we're having. We have a lot of people who are completely uninformed, but for whatever reason, have the most stern, just solid decision, this opinion that, what can you possibly do about that? Okay, right. You know. And that doesn't help anyone. That doesn't help the situation that we're in right now. No, the fact that the sea level is rising. These are facts. And
global temperatures are going up. Yes. Ozone layers
one
thinning.
Degree at a time. And, you know, 1 degree on a global scale is ridiculously... here, let's see. 1 degree in your house on the thermostat, if you change between 70 and 69, is the difference between being grounded for changing your thermostat and nothing happening at all. Right. You will feel the difference between 70 and 69 degrees Fahrenheit. Right. I promise you. Test that tonight. Go wild. Go 68 degrees if you would like to understand what we're talking about, if that's something you'd like to try.
Do you think there's a way to convince people on climate change, or is it just a matter of informing more people, or are we just in a lost cause at this point?
I took an entire semester's course looking at just the facts, the kind of research about this. And it was indirect. It was an indirect conclusion that I came to about climate change while just studying, you know, geologic activity of the past and current geologic activity, you know, earthquakes, whatever, tsunamis, and then looking into everything that has to do with measurements that we've made as scientists, measurements of seismic activity or anything, and eventually you'll see, you know, the numbers. There has never been such a coherent group of numbers as we have sea level rise and carbon in the atmosphere.
Mm.
Well, CO2, whatever.
Right. So people just actively reject that, or?
Well, people need to study that to understand it and study it. You know, right? Studying is not something that just happens for free. I mean, you have to want to study, and you have to actually sit down and then do it.
Right.
And those two things, which are two things that you need to have.
Like, I feel like they're more quick to believe other things that probably fit whatever narrative they want and just reject that.
It's tough for someone, I think, on average, to believe that the whole of a government body, like an entire government party, could possibly say that something isn't real and be wrong. And I think that that's what's weird for a lot of people, is that those who are not informing themselves about it, about climate change, about what it means, what is it, you know, does sea level rise really matter? Is it really happening?
Sure.
That they're, they're looking for the answers in the simplest way possible, which is, what are other people saying? And you'll be surprised how many prominent individuals are expressing these uninformed opinions. They themselves aren't informed. It's not a surprise. It's okay. You'll see it, but check it out.
Right. That's
if you want to convince people, you can't just like attack them. All right, man. Yeah, that's
no, sure, not attack them, but at the same time, but they're so stubborn sometimes. it's difficult to keep a happy face the entire time.
But I refuse to give up on this. I think it's.
No, sure, you can't, because this is a matter for, you know, like, it's true what they say, future generations are going to have to deal with this eventually, even if nothing happens in our lifetime.
You know, yeah, to give a
it's a selfish time view to say, like, oh, let them handle it, you know.
From what I've personally looked into, and that doesn't include just what I've unearthed, but the research that has been published over years of research, activity, whatever, is that you're only going to see the sea level rise issue really impact our daily lives about 60 to 70 years from now. But the thing is that you're going to see it in the form of just like some permanently flooded areas.
We might still
areas.
Be alive by then.
That's what I'm saying. Like,
might see it in our 90s.
I might be here, and if I'm here, I want to know that I did everything I could at this time, and that my generation or the people around me, this America, we could pull this together.
Like Miami could turn like to Wind Waker.
This doesn't. Huh?
Like Miami could turn into Wind Waker.
Venice? What?
No, Wind Waker, you know, the Zelda game, you know,
yeah,
where
know,
just islands and
yeah, no, that's you know. I mean, maybe it sounds cool.
it does from a perspective, but we know that'd be very bad for ecosystems and species and things like that.
Well, it's not I don't think about I don't even go that far. I don't have to go that far, cuz that's
something. No, but it is a matter of concern. The fact that scientists think that we're now in a sixth extinction, that is bad.
That's I didn't want to say it like that because that just sounds like a complete hearsay. But yes, that is what it is. Right. When you look at the previous records,
of mass extinction. That's what I meant.
Yeah. Here's a fun one: if you plant too many trees, you also cause a mass extinction. That was one of them. One of them was that. At some point, the Earth was populated by so many plants, and only plants, that they ate up all of that CO2 and put up so much oxygen that there was nothing to keep heat trapped onto the Earth. And that was when we became a massive ice globe. That's a super fun thing to look up if you want to look into that. We couldn't even if each of us planted 10 trees, every single of the 7 billion plus humans on this planet, we couldn't make that happen again.
True.
But somehow what we've been doing has caused the opposite, where we are entering a heated kind of extinction level climate change.
Mm-hmm. Right, yeah. That, like,
know,
the sixth mass extinction is supposed to be like human induced, according to scientists.
Yeah. I mean, you know, you could blame it on whatever. It's just the fact that you see these things. You know, this is what's so tough is, you know, maybe
you
that's
see it especially also in like countries like Africa where species like the black rhino are just being wiped out, you know.
Yeah. I don't think people would argue that certain species of animals could be wiped
and you know, recently there was also that controversy about big game because with the administration deciding whether or not a big game trophy should be accepted or something along those lines, yeah.
What?
Yeah. And for a while they approved it and said yes, but then there was such a severe backlash, including from people within his own inner circle, that he decided to stop it and look into it, because that would be terrible.
Wait, what is this? What are we talking about?
Huh? We're talking about big game hunting, hunting.
Big game,
elephants, hunting of rhinos.
Oh, okay.
That's what big game is, not like, smaller rodents, but rather like elephants.
Yeah, because I'm over here thinking, I'm like, hey,
But that is something, that is an activity that severely dangers, endangers these certain species. I think one of the more notable examples I can think of like a big game hunt that just experienced massive, outcry was Cecil Lion. You remember?
I do remember hearing about that.
Right. There was a dentist who killed a lion named Cecil in Africa, and he just got slammed by the entire world for...
On the internet, or also like global leaders and so.
I think there were global leaders within the EPA and also in the Wildlife Protection Agency that just had no tolerance for that. I mean, I don't have any tolerance for that. I think hunting's a terrible sport.
Hey, okay. Well, I mean, I understand it, but I'm okay with hunters hunting so long as they follow the don't hunt this particular thing.
I'd rather they not hunt at all. But I wish they could overcome those savage impulses, but
jeez,
that might just be human nature.
It is definitely a human nature thing. I mean, I don't hunt personally, but I mean, I understand that. I would. You can't just like tell me you can't do that thing.
I would probably frown upon that. I mean, one time I actually volunteered in this aviary, and I, my job was pretty much just feeding the birds, cutting up meat and things like that. And there was a guy who worked there who actually said that one of his favorite pastimes was hunting. And I was like, you work with animals. You work in an aviary, in a place where it just doesn't make sense to me. It doesn't make sense to me. I don't know why there's kind of that impulse. It might be human nature, but even then, I've never had that sort of impulse myself, you know what I want to do? I want to kill a rhino,
you've never gone.
Have you ever had impulse? Or
I mean, I've never gone hunting, but I'm not opposed to it. Like,
I'd rather people just express their savagery through video games like Call of Duty or whatever.
Here's my experience with that. Right, somebody brought up the possibility of hunting boar, and then I thought, can you eat it? So it's like, well, yeah. Well, would it taste good? And I'm just thinking, okay, maybe if I want to, on a weekend thing with my friend, we can go hunt a boar, and then like eat that thing throughout the week, and that would be like a fun thing to have done. After doing that once, if that actually works out and it's a fun thing to do, or whatever, I can, I can understand. I can see myself maybe doing that. But,
like, would you kill an animal yourself?
The boar, yeah, if I'm going to eat it. I would have, see, the thing is, I personally, I probably wouldn't. Who cares about virtue signaling? I don't think that I would kill the thing just to kill it. I think I would do it only if I'd only feel good doing it if I ate the thing.
What does virtue signaling have to do with it?
Well, because I'm just sitting here giving my point of view on this. It's kind of a waste of time.
Oh, like appealing
like,
to.
Like, oh, I wouldn't kill the thing if I'm not going to eat it.
I don't think that's virtue signaling. I think that's just a matter of, really, and me, it to me, it's kind of just not so much something that the government should interfere in, because that's
exactly
that's just more of a matter that humans should settle among themselves, and I really don't think they should pursue this any longer.
But I'm totally fine with the government making endangered species.
Like when if we're talking about slaughterhouses, things like that, that's a completely separate matter altogether.
Of course.
That we are going to be debating until the end of time, but this is something that more often than not brings no actual useful thing to the hunter other than something on their mantle, something like that. You don't see people hunting for because of food. They have plenty of food at home. They just do this for fun. And well, I don't get that. I really do not. I don't get the mentality behind that. If you can give me one point aside from, it's fun killing, then maybe I'll listen.
I can't give you a point. I don't know what to tell you. But no, my argument is just let them do it. You don't have to understand everything that people like to do. If it follows the rules that we have for each other, and for sure I understand the addition of rules to let you know that certain things are endangered, just stop killing them because this specific thing will disappear forever, and we don't like that. I'm proud that at the very least we do that. I mean, that's all I have to say about it. I don't want to sit here and talk about the fun of doing the thing because I could care less, you know? And there's a lot of things that I don't understand people, like what my people do it like. I don't know. I haven't been able to bring myself to get a tattoo. Doesn't mean that I think that's a bad thing. It's just,
One has to die to get a tattoo.
I don't know, man. Hey, wait a second.
Depends. Where do you get the ink from?
Depends what prison you're in, man.
Where do you get the ink from? Like a bald eagle or what? Do you kill like an ink monster or like an animal that produces ink out of his snout? Or
I'm just, you know, if you're in the wrong gang, you can't just get a tattoo. I don't know. Well,
and we got
a good time for a song.
Yeah, we got another song for you, and we'll continue this discussion right after the Monkey House.
Keep it locked.
90.5 WVUM,
the University of Miami. We'll be right back.
And that was Terra from Final Fantasy VI. I've never played a Final Fantasy game myself, but that was just beautiful.
Yeah, I'm glad you like that. You know, you probably enjoy Final Fantasy VII, right, with all the games that you've forced me to play. I'm going to have to force you to play
I've only forced you to play one, just Earthbound.
That's right.
You've only played 15 minutes of it, so we still have a lot of work there. But anyways, welcome back to the Monkey House, anyone. I'm Israel.
And I'm Andy.
And if you'd like to text or call in, please do so at 786-309-8861. Once again, that's 786-309-8861. And, you know, we've been gone for 2 weeks, so, you know, sometimes we leave around 8, but, you know we're going to keep going.
That's right. We got this extra bit
We've got
energy
a lot
to go.
Of other stuff to talk about, and then we're just going to wrap up, you know, so.
Did you hear about the UN sanction thing?
These are the strongest sanctions on North Korea in UN history, right?
Yeah. And it sends a unanimous kind of signal to North Korea that the whole world is telling you that, well, what they're saying is that they want North Korea to denuclearize. That's what they're saying. That you need to remove nuclear from your nuclear capabilities.
And how do you think they're going to take this?
Okay. There's two aspects. How do I think they're going to take it? This is asking, right, for him to give up on, in my opinion, what is his only survival option. In his mind, Kim Jong-un can only live so long as he maintains a grip on his nuclear capabilities. That's the only thing that he sees that he has that can keep him alive. You know, and he's seen what happened to Gaddafi and all these other people,
sure,
who lost their capabilities and then subsequently their power and lives. He's not going to do that. So now we have the UN coming in and saying, hey, none of us like what you're doing, and also you need to stop with the nuclear thing.
Okay.
How can they possibly think that that is a legitimate option? How can they possibly think,
right,
that North Korea will listen to that?
I don't think these sanctions will be very fruitful, to be honest with you.
Well, no. And as a matter of fact, if you're paying attention, this... We just had the fourth attempt at the fourth person this year who ran across the 2 mile demilitarized zone.
That is,
which is such a joking misnomer. This is the fourth one. I'm not talking about the guy you saw.
No, the more recent
day.
One, right?
Yeah, you saw it.
And apparently, this was what they called a low level soldier or worker for the DPRK, and. Yeah, he just went across
the
border.
They pulled 10-inch worms out of his body.
That is unfortunate. And, of course, it's also very telling of what North Korean citizens have to go through day by day.
Well, this is telling of what the sanctions are doing. It's obvious. All
right.
It does,
it's kind of just like a no to, you know, like just like a complete condemnation of everything that they're doing.
Well, the complete condemnation of what they're doing boils down to Kim Jong-un,
right,
taking more food away from his own people.
Although I'm sure there's just more concern about the missiles than what's actually going on in North Korea, really.
This is the difficulty, I say, is somehow it's not even being paid attention, apparently.
Right.
You know, the issue, I don't think that North Korea is a danger at all to us. They're a danger to South. They're a danger to South Korea.
You don't think they're a danger,
which is
to
why
us?
Russia and well, one of the reasons why even Russia set up a supposed anti-missile systems along that border between North and South Korea, and that's exactly why we are there, to help South Korea so that they do not get bombarded by North Korea just on some impulse. But what I'm saying is, I don't think that the fear is this nuclear capability at all. I think that we could we could probably neutralize that entire threat within a day if we did our attacks.
You might be a little too confident there.
No, I'm fairly certain about this. This is just from what I understand of how our technology is.
Right. No,
what
no
the, what
missile
are, what we're capable of?
Defense technology is perfect. And you need perfect
missile
in order
defense.
To...
No, this is an attack that destroys their silos or facilities, any possible
capability
that
we
they
do
would
that?
Have. Well, if that was what we wanted to do...
Like, why would
we
strike first? That's...
Oh, well, if we wanted to...
Like, if we knew that would plunge us into war,
world,
why would we do that? Unless they attack South Korea
that's
first.
That's what I'm saying. We wouldn't do that.
Sure.
But we could, probably.
That's why missile defense is the one we have to rely on the most.
No.
And even in that case, you know, if it's not perfect, it could be catastrophe, you know.
Missile defense
Like, you know, THAAD, THAAD.
Well, you're saying that we should rely on that the most. All I'm saying is that unless you're living in some fairy tale world, right, where you're not really totally paying attention to North Korea and what's happening there, you have to understand these sanctions, all they do is keep everything the same except that the people of North Korea, the population there, goes hungrier.
Of course.
That's all that Kim Jong-un does. And he's been doing it for such a long time. And whether they know that we exist, they know we exist. We used to stamp our
the higher ups of North Korea know we exist, but the people.
No, the people do. The grains that we send.
Well, depends,
we send grains to. No, I know this.
Like some
we
prisoners send grains don't. To them. You know, like some people who grow up in these prison camps don't. You know, like that. That
they don't know that the U.S. exists.
Yeah, that like there's some notable. There's some notable examples of, because remember, these are concentration camps, you know, isolated from even, you know, much of North Korea, you know, and guys like Shin Dong-hyuk, you know, who were the focus of books like Escape from Camp 14, never knew about U.S., China, South Korea, up until he met a guy who was cultured, you know, who was brought into the camp in the middle of his adulthood.
How did this guy get into that camp?
Huh?
How was this guy put into that camp? Was he
probably for the same dumb reasons that a lot of people get into camps? You know, like for example, if you crumple up a newspaper that has Kim Jong Un's picture on it, you could go to camp. You know,
okay, right. I mean, this is nothing new.
Draconian reasons like that. Again, nothing new. But Shin was born in this camp, and he was. You know, we've talked about this before. He was taught to believe that reporting his mother and brother for trying to escape is good in the eyes of the North Koreans, and for him, he sees any act like that, any act of escape, you know, traitorous, you know, or treacherous, you know.
Okay.
And they were executed because he reported them. So.
Wow.
A lot of people are very much insulated from the rest of the world to the point where, you know, the devices that they use, you know, the internet that they use is so highly, you know,
they don't
regulated.
Get internet. No, they don't get internet. Nope. They're a slave populace.
I think they do, but it's censored to the point where kind of like how China censors anything about the Tiananmen Square, but just to a highly draconian degree.
That isn't internet. They don't get anything. What is happening in North Korea is that you have people who are forced to go about droning their day-to-day lives as slaves.
Right.
That is the whole point of it. And anyone who seems to be smart enough to do anything is picked out and, let's say, put into a hacker force where they learn how to do that.
Sure.
Only then do you get any type of possible access to the internet where you can learn about other things. But they know about the U.S. because at least many years ago when we were sending grains, we might still be doing that today, in the grains of rice we would imprint from USA.
Right.
But the way that Kim Jong-un, the Kim of that time would phrase it, he would twist this and say, see, we are all powerful, we are the ones, right? That,
and they have spies in other countries.
Even the U.S., you know, they right. give to us because I am God.
Like, did you hear that recent story of a North Korean spy who was arrested in Australia?
Nope.
Yeah, that's something that happened recently. So they know. They're not oblivious at all. They know. They just...
Well, no, they is a tough word. You can't just... paint
North Korean
with this
government.
Broad brush.
The North Korean government.
Well, even in there are many different theys. So the government obviously knows. This is no joke.
Okay.
The government is the one that's doing that.
The higher ups and the foreign ministry, they absolutely know.
Yeah.
No doubt.
Obviously. I mean, that's the whole point of North Korea is that the government there wants to... The government.
And obviously the people who aren't in camps and the people who aren't insulated from everything else... No, because of what North Korean state media is telling them about the, you know, these as they call them, the American traitors or the American murderers or barbarians or whatever. So they know. They just have a very, almost demonic picture of us.
Yeah. They don't understand the state of the world today or what
they
live really
in a fairy tale world, sadly. You know, they've been taught to believe that when Kim Jong-il was born, the flowers bloomed and birds sang in Korean, you know.
Right.
And he was born without a butthole, you know, and just things like that, you know.
Which, yeah, apparently that's part of it.
Apparently that's important to them, I don't know.
Well, yeah, it's... God.
Like, where do you think we're going now with this? Like, do things look good for you?
Well, to me, right? Like, do they look good to me?
Yeah, to you personally.
No, because we're in the same position that we've always been since even before Obama. Before many administrations, North Korea has always been the same kind of threat. Okay, they have nuclear capabilities, right, or they're working towards making that even more lethal, and that's an issue that we need to balance. But if we give sanctions, we're just basically indirectly starving a population, the entire population of that country that is under entire autocracy from the North Korean government.
Sure, but our leaders change, and thus the country's approach to the situation changes.
I don't. Yeah, so maybe it's the leader, or maybe it's just because.
No, it absolutely is a factor.
I mean, why did Kim Jong-un kill his brother so long ago at that time? Like, why did he do that then? Who knows? Why did he kill?
We'll never really know, because I'm sure there's a lot about his life and family history that is not known to
You know, the never really know argument, I think, is a cop-out from trying to at least understand.
I don't think
so. Like, obviously we'll never really know.
Like, why do we really know why Kim Jong-un had his uncle executed?
Yeah. Well, because we saw that happen.
But what specifically did he do to warrant execution?
Well, this is the typical thing. You have to speculate, obviously.
Exactly.
This
is the typical. It's the what if. We can't exactly know what happens because everything in North Korea really is just so secretive, except maybe to intelligence officials. Yeah.
Yeah. It's very secretive, but it's not so secretive that we don't understand what's happening there. When you have a certain sequence of events, let's say like five things happen, now you have a certain amount of guesses that you could throw at the whole thing until your guesses fit enough that perhaps you might now have a full picture of why those things happen. That's the whole point of guessing. Obviously, guessing one thing at a time, like, why did he kill his uncle? I don't know. But now he kills his uncle and then his brother in rapid succession.
No, but that stems to your earlier question, why did he kill his brother? It's the same sort of logic. Why did he kill his uncle?
One way to look at it is that seems to be a natural consequence of him learning the power that he has in his position and getting used to it. I think we can at least extrapolate that he enjoys what he's doing.
Yeah,
or at the very, even less than that, he certainly understands the game and knows enough to know whether or not his life is threatened, his power is threatened. He can see that his power is being threatened. By who? By the evil U.S., by everybody else, whatever, right? And what I'm trying to get across is we can extrapolate that much. He knows that he has this nuclear thing that for one reason or other is gives him leverage over everyone else who is threatening his survival, his existence in his place that he's at. He's not going to get rid of that.
Sure.
And for the UN to come out and seriously believe that them getting together and letting Kim Jong-un know that the whole world wants him to stop with the nuclear thing, to think that somehow is going to work in that favor, I think is ludicrous.
Sure.
I hope they have another motive for that.
And I don't think the president's approach has been working either, because obviously they've only ramped up their program.
No president has had the correct approach to this.
But this president might have the most disastrous approach out of all of them.
He's the no first question that one nuclear to have war actually would be. Done something about it, though.
No.
I don't... No, yes.
Clinton had a deal with North Koreans that just didn't go through. Obama had his position of silence, which
a deal with North Koreans is a lie to oneself.
Right.
You don't get a deal. The thing
it
that
depends on the administration, because you can't lie that saying, you know, Kim Jong-un is far more draconian than his father or his father.
I don't think the level of draconianism matters between the leaders.
The degree to which you're able to negotiate is crucial for solving this sort of issue.
No, I'm saying between the leaders is not the issue. The system in which the leaders are seated into is what has the biggest this grab. And the only reason the only thing that can come out of that is that the person who is seated into it actually fits so well that he takes the mantle that birthed him and runs with it. which is what we're seeing now.
Okay.
We're seeing a Kim Jong-un who was put into that position and enjoys it or whatever, or like however he was put into it, he's owning it now.
Sure.
That has always been. It just so happened that him and the one before him and the one before him have all done that. They've all totally gone full with it. They just love this position or whatever it is. They go for it.
Yeah.
And in all the time that this has been happening, we've never had a president strictly focus on actively addressing the situation. Are we doing it right? I have no clue. I wouldn't know what to do. I don't know what could possibly
be done. You could say we're addressing it, but I think we're addressing it incorrectly.
Well, that's easy to say. We could always say everything's incorrect. But if we did nothing, if we do nothing, their nuclear program will come to further fruition. They might have things that later on we wouldn't be able to stop. It might not be later on so easy that we could wipe it all out in a day, as I seem to believe we can, which might not even be the case.
Right.
Might be much worse than that.
And so there is no good way going out of this. Like, there's no...
No.
Yeah.
No. There's that. That's what's always been disgusting about this.
Right.
Like, are we not just tackling it before has led us to where we are now, where because of not doing anything, they actually have a nuclear program from what we understand. We really have, we're like, okay, we believe it. Our intelligence is completely convinced they have nuclear weapons.
Oh, sure.
And they're willing to do it. That's obvious. Whether willing to do it and thinking that that's the smart idea, I don't think that we don't have enough to understand that. But I don't think that Kim Jong-un wants to do that. I don't think he actually wants to use it. I think he just wants to survive, but he knows that if that's true, then he would know that he needs to keep those nuclear weapons right. to survive in this way. And the UN decision doesn't seem to be the way to go on this. But
it's a very delicate situation, because really, there's no good way going out of it, because if you do nothing, they become more of a nuclear power, and they might be able to threaten areas around them.
I mean, they're shooting past the demilitarized zone. This right. was supposed to be a peace zone. They know the game. This isn't some surprise. And they're course, shooting.
On the other hand, you have just disaster. Yeah. So.
I mean, yeah.
Like, that's the other option, really.
The saddest thing is, I don't think that this would not lead to some kind of a world war. I don't think it merits that kind of potential.
Who knows?
That what it merits
is. No one can predict that.
Well, I mean, I can give the opinion. I think that the worst that can happen here is a genocide of the people of North Korea.
And
those people will, yes, by the government that has held them hostage.
Right.
That's what I would like to avoid, and I don't know. But because of how long we've waited to deal with this situation, which has always been equally as difficult, now they also have this nuclear mix that is very serious. Yeah, that's all I got.
Well, okay. So we got another song for you all to lighten the air a bit. And we will be right back.
This is Merry Christmas here.
Merry Christmas, everyone.
Keep it locked, guys.
This week, Radio University of Miami, WVUM, proudly presents this super hit sound. Number one. Thank you.
And that was Winter's White from Earthbound, everyone. And I hope you all enjoyed this discussion here in the Monkey House on WVM 90.5 FM, The Voice.
Our special Christmas edition of Happiness and Snowflakes.
Right, yeah. Got any closing messages for the families who are probably terrified right now?
Thanks for listening. And I hope you guys, don't try to just, like, avoid politics for a bit. Enjoy time with your family. You know, that's what this is all about.
Right, yeah.
We can have a happy holiday. There's no Grinch stealing Christmas.
Right, don't let anxiety about politics ruin your holidays, that's for sure. Because in the end, the discussion will still go forward, and we will be here in the Monkey House to make you feel worse every single time.
Yeah, we'll be here next week. And,
that'll be
a fantastic time. And that will next week's episode is going to be the last New Year's episode Eve of the season.
Episode, kind of, right?
Yeah. Season one. Yeah, or New Year's Eve.
Right, episode. That'll be the end of our season one. And
Danny KMA, or maybe...
He may not retire.
He might fully retire. And,
Anyways, keep it locked, everyone. Happy holidays, Merry Christmas, Hanukkah, Kwanzaa, whatever. And thank you all for joining us, and good night.
Good night.